Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
This is Dan and Matt back with you for the final day of the Flames development camp and the final on-ice sessions. Matt, today we saw the scrimmage, the thing that most people are looking forward to. Can you believe how many people there were at Winsport today?
I don't think you could stick any more fans in that arena, that's
for
sure.
There's probably, what, about 200 seats in that arena?
247, if I recall correctly.
And then they were all full. There were people standing behind those, and then there's about two layers of people standing around the rink. So I'd probably say there was 400 or 500 people in that rink.
Yeah, if not more. It's about the same amount that's come out for previous scrimmages in prior years.
And today we saw the Flames split all the guys at training camp into two groups. We had the team wearing red, which was known as Team McDonald, against the team wearing white, which was known as Team Neuendijk. And it was a bit better split this year than last year. Last year they put kind of all the haves versus the have-nots, if you will. It was all the, you know, top prospects, the guys against the guys that weren't as much the top prospects, the guys that were walk-ons and that sort of thing. And it was fairly well distributed this year. We won't go through the whole roster, but I'll put a roster in the show notes so anyone who wants to see it can. The only three that didn't participate were Riley Bruce, Andrew Mangiapane, Daniel Preble, and Gillies did not participate. He got hurt yesterday, and I think they just kept him out because they know what they've got there. They don't need to evaluate him. In the end, though, we had a 6-1 score in favor of Team McDonald. The goals came from Ryan Culkin, Spencer Fu, one of the walk-on guys, Adam Olis Mattsson, and Itu Tulola got a hat trick, got three goals for his team, and on the white team, only Sheldon Rempel, one of the walk-ons, got a goal. Matt, any overall thoughts about today's scrimmage?
I thought it was interesting that the Flames decided to put most of the good forwards on one team and most of the good defensemen on the other team.
Yeah, and
just to give that, like, you get to evaluate the defensemen better because of the fact that you've got the best forwards coming at them instead of an even split.
Yeah, I mean, if we look at Team McDonald, we had Austin Carroll, Spencer Fu, we had Jankowski, Mattsson, Hunter Smith, Matthew Tkachuk, and Tulola, who are all the forwards in that team. And if we look at Team Neuendijk, the defensemen there, we had Adam Fox, Hickey, Kanzig, Shillington, Morrison, and Jared Wilson. So, yeah, you're right. It was kind of the forwards against the defensemen on this one. Probably the reason why the red team won as well is they had more firepower.
Exactly. And you could even see that the game, outside of a handful of softer goals let in by David Rittich, the teams were fairly evenly matched throughout the game. Like, none of the forwards were given much space by the defense.
So each team had two goaltenders. The red team, Team McDonald, had Mason McDonald and Nick Schneider. It's apt that McDonald played for Team McDonald. And the white team, Team Neuendijk, had David Rittich and Tyler Parsons. They did the scrimmage in two halves instead of three periods. So each goalie played one half, and then there was a shootout. And, yeah, I think
McDonald and Parsons each surrendered one goal apiece. Schneider gave up nothing, and Rittich with five goals against.
And, Matt, I mean, you talked in the first day on Tuesday about you didn't think Rittich looked all that great. I don't think every goal against Rittich was soft, but, yeah, he didn't look great today. I mean, he let in some soft ones. He let in some that he probably didn't have as much a chance on, but just overall I didn't think, as far as the goalies go, that he really showed very well.
No, and it happens. He will be back for more games in the preseason and such. It's his first time on North American ice as well, so you have to remember that he's facing different shots from different angles than he's used to, so it helps to explain the five goals against.
And, you know, Treliving and Gulletson both, when we talked to them this week, made it very clear they're not evaluating players. They're not sitting here and saying, you know, oh, so-and-so didn't do well in a July scrimmage, so we think they're going to be destined for the AHL, or, you know, we think that they're going to be in the NHL. They're just kind of letting these guys develop and looking at skills, but they don't want to do a lot of evaluations. So I think that's probably good for Rittich, because it almost gives them a second chance.
Yeah, and realistically, with things like this or the Penticton tournament, it's just a snapshot in time of, okay, how is this guy progressing? Is he doing all right? Are there regressions in any of the person's skills, like we have seen with a couple of players? Are they exceeding expectations? All that kind of thing. Like, you're not going to say definitively, oh, Jankowski had a good couple of days in practice, so therefore he's going to be penciled into the starting lineup. He's still going to have to fight through the Penticton tournament, training camp, and possibly right through to the last day, right before the regular season, even. So, not, you can't take too much away from any particular event, but if a player is stringing along several good performances from several events, it just shows that he might be closer to being ready than somebody who has starts and stops along the way.
Some points that I'd made notes of during the scrimmage today. I thought that Mitchell Mattson, number 91, who the Flames drafted this year in the draft, looked quite good out there. There's a couple shifts where he was playing with Jankowski, so that probably helped him look good. But as far as a lot of the players who were signed this year, I mean, we saw Dubé had a good day. We saw Tulola had a good day. Mattson had a good day. That was really good to see. But I was noticing Mattson a lot right in front of the net, especially in the first half.
And he's a very raw prospect. He's not going to be ready anytime soon. Like, he probably will spend all 4 years in the NCAA and then either get signed or not at the end of that. Again, showing well for where he is developmentally, and that's a good thing. Hopefully he progresses throughout his first season in the NCAA, and we can see more of him next year.
I was pleased to see that Keegan Kanzig, who we talked a little bit about yesterday, he was really jumping into the rush. I mean, he talked to us about how he needed to put a bit more offense into his game, and we're seeing that today. He was a force in front of the net. He was really throwing guys around, trying to get that puck, bringing it in from the blue line.
Even had a breakaway.
Yeah, he did. He had a breakaway as well. So I was really happy to see that, you know, he's working on that, and we're seeing that, you know, Keegan has those results showing up for him.
Yeah, and he was pretty much the penultimate raw prospect. Like, he was just 6'7" and physically tough. Now he's working at, like, each year he's taking steps forward. He's not going to be a complete player right away, but he's adding different parts to his arsenal. And if he can figure it all out, then he'll be a very good player for the Flames in a couple of seasons. He's just, every time we see him, he seems like he is progressing in a good forward direction. So as long as he keeps that up, that's the important thing.
He's one of these guys that I think was well served to have been sent back to the WHL last year. He played a little bit at the AHL level and then got sent back to the Dub. And I think that for where he's at, and the minutes he was getting in the A, the Dub was the best place for him.
Yeah, and he was able to be used in a different manner as well. The Hitmen used him as an offensive defenseman at times, which was not something that he was used to, but it did help him develop that some comfort in actually jumping up into the play, where he would not have done that a year ago.
And we saw that today. I mean, we saw him jumping into the play when he needed to, but he's a kind of a unique guy because he can also play that very defensive role. And if he can keep honing both sides of his game, it's hard to find a good utility defenseman that can be good at both sides.
Yeah, and like, eventually, if he only becomes a Derek Englund-style defenseman where you might only get 5 or 10 points out of him in a season, but he can bring that physical component night in and night out, that is something that the Flames are lacking. So that's what hopefully he turns into, and hopefully there's something more there as a complete defender.
Another defender on the Team Neuendijk, the white team that I really liked today, was Oliver Shillington. You could tell that Shillington had a year of pro hockey under his belt. I mean, just the way that he was playing against some of the forwards, he looked fantastic out there.
Yeah, once he gets going, you can't catch him. And he can go from basically being stopped to full speed in like two or three strides. So he will be giving a lot of people fits moving forward for the opposing team. And I would not be shocked if he saw a little bit of action in the NHL this season. He's probably still a year away from full-time duty, but I would not be shocked. I would actually be surprised next year if he wasn't on the opening day lineup.
He played one game this past season.
Yes.
He'll play definitely more than
the final game.
I don't know if he'll be on the opening day lineup. To me, I think that he will be one of the first young call-ups that we're going to bring up. I don't know if he'll be
sort
the first
like
call-up.
Kulak. But... Yeah, sort of like Kulak last year, where he got a few different opportunities throughout the year. Next year, though, like 2017, 2018, I think he should be starting from day one.
If he's not, it means that either probably... I agree with you. If he's not, I think it means that somebody's either...
Something's gone
or,
wrong.
Or somebody's really excelled and jumped way above him on the depth chart. But I look at him as sort of number one on the prospect depth chart for the blue line. As in terms of the white team, Matt, the Neuendijk team, anybody else that really stood out to you?
Adam Fox made some good outlet passes. Wasn't too bad defensively. The whole team, though, was kind of mediocre, which isn't really a surprise.
No, I think that for me, as far as the forwards, Braden Burke, who is a walk-on, looked pretty good to me. He was one of the few forwards I noticed on that team that was doing, I don't want to say doing the right things, but just always in the right spot. He always seemed to be right in front of the net when he needed to be. Linus Lindstrom, I was hoping to have seen more of today. But Sheldon Rempel, number 89, who scored the only goal for that team, he's a walk-on. I thought he looked quite good. Like, he was battling in the corners a lot. If I didn't know any better, I wouldn't have thought that he was one of the walk-on players.
Can't argue with
you. One guy that I was a bit disappointed with was Tim Harrison. Harrison's been around here for a while. He's been an NCAA guy. I just didn't see anything from Harrison that really stood out.
Yeah, he would be the one guy that, if you're looking for forward progression from year to year, we didn't really see that this year from him.
No, and I mean, to me, he just doesn't have an identity. Like, there's a lot of these guys that we're talking about their identity, and we're talking about Keegan Kanzig and the type of player he is, and we're talking about Shillington, the type of defenseman he is. To me, I just don't see any identity from Tim Harrison. He's just there playing hockey. And I think that he needs to establish who he is as a player, especially at these camps. I'm just not seeing that from him anytime I see him.
Yeah. And that's unfortunate, but unless he has a big season this year in the NCAA, his final year there, I'm not sure he'll be back.
Yeah, I agree. I also did like number 50 on the Neuendijk team, which is Brandon Hickey. I thought that Hickey was doing a lot of good things to create pressure up the middle in his own end. There's a few times they took the puck right off someone else's stick, and there's a few times that he was causing quite a lot of just confusion on the boards. You know, sticking his stick around people, trying to get in between their legs, just doing all the little things that you need to do as a defenseman.
Yeah, and he was even engaging a little bit physically, which we didn't really see too much the previous times that we've watched him play.
No, and not something that Hickey's known for either.
Yeah, but he's also gone, as Treliving said, from being 185 pounds when he's drafted to now he's 208. So that's a big difference, and now he's more NHL-sized. And so now he's able to utilize his strength to push people off the puck, and use his stick better and more effectively. I thought he was the most complete of all the defensemen today.
Yeah, I would agree with that. He definitely looked complete. He definitely looked like one of the older guys, one of the guys that's done this before.
Yeah. I could see him along, like, if he wasn't heading back to the NCAA, I could see him fighting with Shillington for that first call-up.
And, you know, I think that Hickey is still best used in the NCAA. I wouldn't turn him pro just to turn him pro. Boston University's got a great program. That's where I think he's best used right now. But I'm excited to see what we've got in Brandon Hickey going forward.
Well, we also have a few defensemen, the older draft picks, that the Culkins, the Kulaks, the Wotherspoons, that are pretty much nearing the end of their line in the Flames organization, much like guys like Agostino and Arnold. So having Hickey coming in this year wouldn't make a lot of sense, because you need to see if the older group will have any progression and emerge as NHL caliber defensemen, or if they're just decent but not quite good enough.
Yeah, and for some of those guys, too, I think they were almost at the end of the line, if you will. You know, I think if guys like Culkin and Kulak aren't moving up from the AHL level or becoming, you know, 1-2 defensemen, I think they're getting to that age where with guys like Hickey pushing, they're going to have to be phased out of the system pretty soon.
Yeah, because you got to figure that next year Hickey is likely going pro. Anderson's likely going to be there as well. Animalus Mattson's going to be. Well, where do you stick him at that rate? So the spots will have to be opened up on the blue line. And the only way to do that is to move other players. So if they're not elevating their game, they will likely be dealt or let go either way. At some point this
season. We talked about number 40, David Rittich, for the Neuendijk team. Tyler Parsons was the other goaltender, the second-round pick from this year. To me, you could tell that Parsons had the least experience of all the goaltenders. He didn't let in a lot of goals, but just the way he was moving and the way he was reacting to players, especially some of the guys like Culkin, you know, Jankowski, who were coming in on him and have more experience than he does, have that pro experience and are a little bit faster and quicker thinking, you could just tell that Parsons was a little bit lost there, which is to be expected, I guess. You know, I mean, he's a junior goalie. This is his first time out. But to me, he definitely got exposed as being sort of the most inexperienced goalie of the bunch.
Oh, yeah. But if you recall back when Mason McDonald made his first appearance, there wasn't really much difference between either Parsons or McDonald. So it is what it is. And a young, inexperienced goaltender that's not familiar with things. So you don't get performances like what Nick Schneider threw out in training camp last year too often from an 18-year-old goaltender.
And it earned him a contract.
Yeah, because you're stopping guys like Gaudreau. Yeah, you're worthy of getting a contract.
So let's move on to Team McDonald then. I thought it was interesting to put Rasmus Anderson on this team. I guess they needed to give him some defensive muscle. But this was the forward-heavy team, and we saw goals from Culkin, Fu, Olus Mattsson, and three of them from Tulola. Let's start with Tulola, a guy I wasn't expecting a lot of impact from in this scrimmage, much less the whole camp. He was probably, if not, you know, the best, one of the best forwards all day.
Yeah, and throughout the camp, he was always a notable player each day. So, and that's a positive sign.
Well, and it's easier to be notable in the, you know, the practice drills and stuff, but I wasn't sure how he was going to do when we put him on the ice in an on-ice situation.
Yeah, exactly.
In a game situation, I should say.
And he acquitted himself very well. Anytime you get a hat trick, period, that's a good game. Now he needs to show that again. There is some talk that he may join Everett, the Silvertips in the WHL, who drafted him in the Euro draft.
Yeah, Treliving was mentioning that to us at the end of the day, that he got drafted in the import draft, and it's not confirmed yet, but Treliving thinks that he might end up playing in North America, and I think that would be a good choice for Tulola.
Yeah, especially with his type of brand of hockey. He's more of a David Wolf style of guy, like a bigger physically type guy that will hit and engage physically, but in his case, he's more fast and able to generate offense. So, a decent player, and I think he'd benefit a lot more from the smaller ice, where he can use his physicality on the forecheck instead of skating a lot more like he would in Finland.
I mean, if we sat here yesterday and predicted who was going to score a hat trick, it probably would have been number 19, Matthew Tkachuk, or number 77, Mark Jankowski. I don't think anyone would have predicted Tuulola.
That might have been one of my dark horses because of how I played in the other games, but that would have been like the dark horse pick, not the likely pick.
Some other good players in this team. I thought Dylan Dubé did well all day. He was where he needed to be. He was really well positioned on the ice. He knew, you know, who his man was. He was always checking the right man. And I also thought that Adam Olsson-Mattsson, from a defensive perspective, looked pretty good out there for at least the second half. I was really watching him in the
second half. I thought Olsson-Mattsson was probably the most surprising of any of the players today. And like his profile, he's more of a defensive-minded player. But he was engaging both on the offensive side of the puck. He scored a goal, if I recall correctly. And yet he was also throwing hits around and separating players quite effectively. He did make a couple of mistakes, but on the whole, I was quite impressed by him.
And I think maybe Olsson-Mattsson shined a little bit more as a defenseman because he was on the team that was very forward-heavy. I think he might have got lost if he was on the Nieuwendyk team.
Possible, but another one of those situations where he acquitted himself well. Now, next time, go and do it again. So, and cut the few mistakes that he made. By the way, I want to go back to the white team, because we did forget one player that stood out really well, and that was Matthew Phillips.
Yeah.
The 6th-round pick from this past draft. In the shootout, he had one of the most deft moves of anybody. Came in quick on Mason McDonald and completely undressed him for the goal. It was probably the best single highlight of the entire scrimmage in its totality.
So for those that don't know the way the scrimmage worked, they started each half with 5-on-5, and then every couple minutes they took a player off until we were down to 3-on-3. So it was 5-on-5 hockey, then 4-on-4, then 3-on-3 hockey. And then after each half, they had half the white shooters and half the red shooters do a shootout shot on their goaltenders. So we got to see a little bit of everything, a little bit of every scenario. Yeah, you're right. I think Phillips came in. I mean, he's a small guy, and he was wearing number 47 in this week. I don't think a lot of people were expecting much from him because of his size, but he's definitely showing why, as much as they say the NHL is a big man's game now, you can... If you know what you're doing, you can do well as a smaller guy. He had that speed, and he was able to avoid some of the big checkers.
Yeah, and Calgary does have that history of affording opportunities to smaller players like Phillips and getting successful results from that. Theo Fleury, Martin St-Louis, even though he didn't really find that success here, he did get his start. And, of course, some so-so player that's on the team right now. So, you know, it helps. I think of all the 30 teams in the NHL, I think Calgary was the best fit from a opportunity standpoint for him because of our experience with the other players in the franchise's history.
Yeah, I mean, Phillips looked good out there today. I want to see him in preseason when he's playing with some more experienced guys, see how he stacks up there as well. But I think there's definitely a lot to like with this prospect going forward.
Yeah, and he just has to keep showing, like, as he moves forward, more improvement, and especially a lot of it will be determined once he turns an actual pro and heads to Stockton. if he can translate his offensive game from junior to Stockton, then you'll see him probably eventually crack the Flames lineup. If he has that, hits that ceiling there, he might turn into the next Brian Cameron.
I think for me, Phillips is a long shot either way for the NHL, but I mean, it's possible he can make it, but I think he's a long shot to get a roster spot.
Yeah, he'd have to show like elite level scoring. Like, if he continues to show that both at the junior level and the AHL level, he will get an opportunity. So it's just if then, and right now we're still in the if stage, so we'll have to just wait for 2 or 3 years to see how he does. But an intriguing prospect nonetheless.
And you know, the nice thing about Phillips is he's playing in the dub, and he's playing in and he's playing for Victoria, and playing with Dave Lowry. And, you know, Dave Lowry, as we know, is a former Flame. I think that's a good development environment for him and a good environment to make sure the Flames keep knowing what's going on with him. And that's what you want, especially for a guy like this who's smaller, who's maybe not the first guy you think of in terms of great prospects, keeping that eye on them constantly and working with them. I mean, you know, we're in BC all the time playing Vancouver. It's not that far if we want to go down there. Like, you know, I just think him being close to the team is going to help him out a lot. And he's a Calgary boy, too, so he's going to be coming to Calgary quite a bit.
Yeah, we spoke this afternoon with his grandparents, which was a pleasant experience as well.
Yeah, of course, you know, they're very happy with Matthew and what he's done, what grandparents are. And I've never heard a grandparent who's not proud of their grandchildren. But, yeah, I mean, they think that it's so awesome that he's getting to wear a Flaming C. Matt, going back to the red team, I think for me, when I was watching the scrimmage today, Ryan Culkin stood out, not necessarily because he was one of the better defensemen on the ice, but you could just tell that he's played pro hockey. Like, just some of the decisions that he'd made, some of the way he moved his body and the timing he had, you can tell this guy was probably the most experienced guy out there.
I thought offensively he was fairly decent. Defensively, I think he was the worst of all the defensemen in the game today. So, he does have a lot of experience, but his decision-making when pressured, like right off the bat, he gave the puck over to a guy right in front of the net, and there was a lot of sloppy plays off of his stick in the defensive zone. Offensively, he was good. It's just, you would expect a little more, I think, from somebody with as much experience at this point.
To me, you're right, he was in the offensive game a lot, but to me, he was almost too offensive. He was playing like a winger sometimes. Like, I looked over a few times, and there he was behind the net, the attacking net. It's like, dude, you're a blue liner. You should not be that deep into the attacking zone.
I agree. So, that's one of those things, because he's missed so much time developmentally due to freak injuries, that he has to work on finding that correct balance. Sort of like what Shillington went through last year, because he was very much an offense-only type defenseman, and Todd Gill had to break him of those habits a bit so that way he could become a more complete player. So I think Gill will be working with Culkin a lot this year to see if he can rough out those edges.
And the only real standout for me on the red team as far as walk-on guys was the guy who scored one goal, number 95, Spencer Foo. To me, all week leading up to this, Foo's just looked like another one of the walk-ons. There was nothing special about him. He hadn't, you know, really caught my eye for any reason. But today I thought that he was battling hard. He was where he needed to be. He was doing the right things on every one of his shifts.
Yeah, I don't think he did enough to earn a contract, personally. But he did play well. We'll just have to see if he has another good season in the NCAA. He might be back this time next year. secondary look?
I think that Spencer Foo is a long-term prospect if you do sign him. I don't think you sign him yet, but I think this might be a guy like we've seen in the past with
Juris and Hathaway.
But even outside those guys, some of these guys like Tyson Bailey, who have come every year and, you know, were a big part of that camp over time, and the Flames in the end opted not to go that direction. I think this is a guy we might see at camp for 2-3, you know, maybe even 4 years in a row. He's 22 already, before they make a decision on him.
Well, I think it'd be next year only, just due to his age.
Well, you could come to the Flames camp next year, but I would not be surprised to see him getting a look at a Stockton camp.
Yeah.
He played for Bonnyville in the AJHL, and now he's at Union College. I don't think that Foo is necessarily going to be an NHL-ready prospect or a guy you want to use one of your 50 contracts on, but I just thought it was interesting that he was out there. Considering the forwards on his team, you know, you look at, you've got Tkachuk, you've got, you know, guys like Smith, you know, you had Mattson out there, Jankowski, that he was still able to stand out with those guys on his roster. And the goaltenders on this side, we had Mason McDonald and Nick Schneider. I thought that McDonald, as far as the four goalies that played today, looked the most polished for sure. Yeah, he got undressed on one shot in the shootout, but I thought he looked the most polished. And I saw a better performance than I thought I would from Nick Schneider. He had a good camp last year. That's how he earned a contract. Schneider, to me, is the long shot goaltender. I don't think he's ever going to be an NHL goalie. But he looked better than I expected him to coming in with the other goaltenders that we had around.
I actually am going to disagree and flip it for the red team's goalies. I thought Schneider was a little bit more composed and solid in his net and more square to the shooters. McDonald still needs to tighten things up in his game, but not bad. I think Schneider, if he continues to progress and shows more as he gets older, he might eventually make the NHL. He'll have a tough hill to climb, though, getting over Parsons, McDonald, and Gillies, though. But anytime you have a goalie that's throwing up decent performances each time you see him, as long as he keeps doing it, see how it goes. And he's looked pretty good every time I've seen him, so why not see how it fares? And he looked good in the AHL last year, so you never know. Like, Martin Jones was another unsigned goalie that kind of came out of nowhere and went all the way to the Stanley Cup Finals this past season. So goalies are a bit weird where they can come out of nowhere. And who knows, Schneider might be one of those, or he might not ever reach the NHL. Still too early to tell.
I think positioning-wise, you're right. I don't think McDonald was the better of the two, but I was getting the sense that McDonald was reading the game better. You saw him, I think, reading the game, knowing where guys were supposed to be. He wasn't always challenging them the way he should have been, but there was a few times when it looked like Nick Schneider lost track of the puck or lost track of what was going on around him.
Yeah, I can see where you're coming from. So,
you know, and I mean, I think part of the play of these guys might just be they haven't been on the ice in a while.
Exactly. I wouldn't be shocked if most of the players that were there, because it's not training camp, like, they're not coming into this at 100%.
So that was really the end of what we saw today as far as the last day of camp goes.
Well, we should talk a little bit about the two important players, the highest of the profile guys, Tkachuk and Jankowski, a bit.
What do you want to chat about?
Well, they kind of disappointed today.
I think they did and they didn't. I think it depends how you look at it. To me, Jankowski knows he's a pro. You know, he's turned pro. He's got a pro contract. He has nothing to prove in this game. He's not trying to earn a contract spot or get a better position. He's got, I think, an AHL or an NHL spot locked up next year. So what did he have to prove? I think he might have been out there trying to help other guys. I mean, we saw him, you know, setting up some of the other forwards. Why go out there and maybe bust your butt when you don't have to? For Tkachuk, I think he's played a long season. I mean, he went all the way to the Memorial Cup. He's played a lot of hockey. I think he might just be tired.
I agree.
Like, we saw him in the drills. He was doing pretty well, but it's different playing drills than in a game scenario. I also think that Tkachuk might have, you know, he's so used to playing with guys he knows that now being put onto a lineup with guys he's not really sure of, I think might have changed some of what he's used to as well. So I hate to evaluate two guys based on one scrimmage, but I'm not too worried about what we saw.
Yeah, I just wanted to touch on them because of the fact that they are who they are. I agree. Jankowski looked like he was trying a little too hard to make every play look perfect. And that anytime you're trying too hard, that tends to not go so well. And Tkachuk at times, like, he is recovering from an ankle injury as well, so you have to keep that in mind. And he did show flashes of skill. Anytime that you're getting high quality prospects like them, you can see the skill readily evident in their game. It's just they're not necessarily giving 110% effort. Like, Sam Bennett pretty much played the same way his first camp like this, so...
And I don't think that either guy was terrible today. I mean, Jankowski, especially in the first half, has spent a lot of time in front of the net. He knew what his game was, but, you know, I think that he just wasn't, like you said, wasn't putting in the 110% that he might have in a game. He's got nothing to gain out of this camp.
No, and you might get hurt accidentally, sort of like Hunter Smith. So, you don't need to. Just like not playing Gillies today. Like, he has a little bit of hip injury problems still, just on the recovery aspect. So, there's no need to rush him and possibly re-aggravate the problem.
And honestly, I think the scrimmage is a lot for the fans. I mean, as you mentioned, we had hundreds of fans there. The fans want to see these guys out there.
So, well, not only that, it's to reward the players because, you know, doing drills all day is a little boring for anybody.
Yeah,
so,
but I mean, if
just
it was...
allowing their competitive spirit out.
For sure. But I mean, it's, you know, they're doing it for the players, for the fans. I think that they put these guys into the game for the fans. You know, the fans really wanted to see them. I think that if the camp was set up differently where no fans were allowed, they may not have even had Tkachuk and Jankowski on the ice.
That's possible.
Any other players that stand out to you?
Not
either
really.
Good or bad?
I thought Parsons did okay. That was about it. At times, Hunter Smith and Rasmus Anderson looked a little gassed. But
yeah, I think
again,
those guys
that's
too,
a continuation of what our conversation of was yesterday.
Yeah, and I think those guys are role players. You know, they're low minute role player guys. They've, you know, not had a lot of hockey, and I think they were pretty much rolling the lines today, so they might just not be used to playing that many minutes on ice.
Yeah, and like Rasmus Anderson previously said that like this was like the first time he skated all off season, so. That too.
Fitness level may not be exactly where it needs to be on Rasmus.
No. Even Treliving was commenting today about that. So
and
we'll see how he is in training camp.
Yeah, and that's going to be for me the real test of these guys is do they go away from this rookie camp, come back in training camp in better condition or, you know, doing something differently than we see? If we're not seeing that upward progress, that's where it starts to get a little disturbing.
Yeah, like especially with Anderson, if he's. He looks about 10-15 pounds overweight still, and like last year he was a lot more overweight than he is this year. So there's been progress, but not as much as I'm sure that the Flames organization would have liked. So hopefully he can commit to his exercise regime and nutrition regime so that way come September he's in top shape.
I mean, we have to remind people that when we say these guys aren't in top shape, it's not like, you know, he's in the same shape as Matt and I. I mean, he's still a pro athlete. You know, he's still in better shape than most people. He's just not where the Flames want him to be. And part of what they were doing off ice this week is they were teaching these guys how to cook. They were teaching them about nutrition. So I think that taking some of that, you know, and being around these guys and seeing that, oh, wow, this is the level where everyone is, hopefully that's motivation as well. you know, kind of looking around and almost, well, if I want this guy's spot, I have to be where he is on these fitness tests and, you know, this level of nutrition and that sort of thing.
And that's a work in progress. Sometimes players get it right off the bat. Other times it takes a lot more prodding than not.
And Anderson's playing in the Canadian League too, which you can get away with a little bit more there than you could if he was in the AHL or, you know, playing in some of the higher level leagues.
Precisely. And you could see in his stat sheet, he was one of the top players in the OHL. So, you know, you can get away with that in that level, but he's ready for the AHL, at least offensively in his overall makeup, but with his current conditioning, that might be a little bit of an issue.
Anybody else here that, I mean, we talked a little bit about Anderson being a little bit of a disappointment that way. Anyone else disappointed?
Not really. I was actually pleasantly surprised that nobody stood out as being terrible based on expectations moving in.
Yeah, and
this tournament.
We've talked over the last couple of days that no one disappointed us in the first couple of days, and today was when I was expecting one or two guys to really disappoint in the game scenario, and I agree with you. There was nobody that did.
Some might have not progressed as much as you'd like Culkin, but there was no significant regressions from anybody.
Yeah.
Like Zielov last year, he regressed quite a bit, so.
And even Culkin, though, I mean, he still looked like one of the best guys in the ice.
Yeah.
In, you know, in the role that he was playing.
Yeah, in the offensive role, yes.
Yeah, and I think that he might have been asked by coaching staff to play that role. One thing I did find interesting, and I commented to Matt afterwards, is even after the scrimmage, they all went to the center ice and raised their sticks, as we see at every Flames game. So the organization's already trying to get that sort of mentality, that fans-first mentality, into these kids, which I think is awesome. You know, they are entertainers, let's be honest.
Yeah, and it's good to have positive interaction with the fans. Like we saw after they got off the ice, a lot of them were signing autographs for all the kids involved, so that were there to watch. So that was a good thing, and just getting used to doing those kind of things.
And even throughout the week, I mean, you know, there was always autographs being asked for when the guys got off the ice, but during the week, you'd see these guys up at the concession stand buying a smoothie or coming out of the gym, and there's always little kids around asking them to sign autographs. And no matter who it was, they were always obliging that. It was always, yeah, sure, I'd be happy to do that or take a picture, whatever the fans wanted. So we know that's an important thing to Brian Burke and the Flames organization, and they're really instilling that in these kids, even the walk-on guys. I mean, you know, some people wanted their autograph because they're on the Flames ice, and everyone made that time to do it. And even today after camp, I mean, there were some players like Brandon Hickey, who was the last guy out of there, who made sure that everybody who wanted him got to see him. So I think that's really important instilling these guys young, especially guys like Tkachuk, like Jankowski, who are probably going to be more face of the organization. Talking about Tkachuk, it was announced today that he also signed his entry-level deal. So the Flames assigned him to a 3-year entry-level deal, his first NHL contract. Somebody asked him if he's spoken with his dad yet to talk about the difference in pay between him and his dad when his dad played. We knew this was coming. I mean, Matt, this was inevitable, wasn't it?
Yeah. Whether it was done today, tomorrow, next week, next month, it was going to get done before the training camp, so why not get it out of the way? There's not really any difference between any of the higher level entry level contracts, so doesn't make any difference.
No, and I mean, if they were going to get it done, which we knew they would, it's not like you can, as a rookie, there's a maximum salary. It's not like you can hold these guys for, you know, $7 million a year if you want to. We knew it would be done before the main camp came. That way it's taken care of and he's eligible for playing this season if they want him to. So not surprised they came this early.
Same thing happened with Sam Bennett, so not surprised whatsoever.
And that was the only real news today. We'd seen Trilivine on the phone for a while. We thought there might have been another big deal. It's probably just hammering out the details of the Tkachuk contract. We don't know any terms on that. We don't know what the bonuses are, or the incentives, or anything like that. But, you know, I imagine these are all pretty standard.
I'd pretty much just look at what Bennett got, and there's your contract. I don't see there being any difference, really, so...
No, I don't think there's going to be much.
The same standard for pretty much anybody, so...
You'd point out today that some other news, not really Flames news, but stuff that will affect the Flames, both prospects this year and probably the NHL going forward, with some changes to the AHL rules. We know the NHL likes to try out new rules in the American League, see how they work, and then implement them in the NHL later if they work. So some interesting rule changes in the AHL that are coming up for the 2016-2017 NHL season. Matt, do you want to explain the new fighting rules?
Yes, for each of the fights, if you start a fight off a face-off, your staged fights, so to speak, that gets you an automatic game misconduct right off the hop. So they want the fighting to grow organically, like something to cause it instead of, oh, hey, you're there. Let's go. Okay, sure.
Which, I mean, you remember the big Calgary-Vancouver line brawl a couple years ago where everyone started fighting off the face-off? That's where we see a lot of fights. It's just the staged, you know, right at the face-off,
get it
the
out of the,
and let's go.
Yeah, get it out of the way and let's carry on with the game. Well, there's no point to that, so get rid of that. And if a fighter has 10 fights in a season, they get suspended for one game. Then from every fight, the 11th, 12th, and 13th, they get a one-game suspension for each. And on the 14th and more, they get a two-game suspension for each. So they're trying to cut down on, especially in the AHL, where there was a number of guys that were basically fighting at any opportunity. There was one guy who had 21 fights last year. They're just trying to get rid of that type of guy from the AHL entirely.
Brian McGrattan today retweeted a tweet from Richard Clune, who's another AHL player, that says, I'll save you reporters some time. The 10-fight limit and no fighting at the face-off rule is great. Fighting isn't done, just guys who suck are. Paul Bissonnette, we all know the Biz Nasty, posts a lot on Twitter. He said, in all honesty, I don't mind the new rules. Still believe there's a place for fighting in the game, but not at the level where it was. And, you know, I'd have to agree with both those guys. I think fighting, we have to remember, fighting's never been part of the rules. It's always been illegal. It's a penalty. But I do think there's a place for a fight to turn the momentum. I think there's a place for a fight when, you know, someone's taking liberties on another teammate. But, you know, most guys should not be having 14 fighting majors in 1 year. And I think this really just goes to further get rid of that role of the enforcer on the team.
Yeah, and... like, we've seen, like, Ginla, when he would drop the gloves with somebody, there was always a reason. Like, it's not like, oh, well, let's just go. So, they wanting fighting to be more like that, where there's some reason for it, whether it's an argument on the ice or some incident that happened on the ice, having that internal policing, yet not having just your rent-a-goon type player where that's their only job and they do it and that's it. Like, we don't need that type of player in the NHL moving forward.
Yeah, and I think that's all this is going to do, is just eliminate that guy whose job it is just to fight. The Rocky Thompson, the, you know, Brian McGrattan, the Sandy McCarthy, all those kind of guys who, that was their job. I mean, their job is just to fight. And I think there's still a place for tough players, don't get me wrong, guys that can fight, guys that know how to fight, guys that are agitators and your sandpaper guys. But yeah, just hiring a player who's a crappy hockey player but knows how to, you know, how to win a fight, we don't need those guys in the league. We want talented hockey players.
Yeah, because like, you look at some of the fighters that the Flames had, like Andre Roy and a handful of others, like they couldn't play it at all, period. Like, they were a complete liability for the 4 minutes that they might see in a game. Well, those players, like, it sucks that their job's gone, but the NHL is changing, and that's not needed anymore. You need somebody that can actually play 10 minutes, like a Michael Ferland type, but somebody like that who can actually fight on a regular basis as well. Like, you know what I mean?
A couple other rules that were put in this year for the AHL not related to fighting. In addition to not being permitted to make player substitutions on an icing, the offending team may not use its team timeout anymore. So before we'd see that, you know, when you ice the puck, if your team ice the puck, you can't make a change, but the other team can. And sometimes teams were getting around that by just taking their timeout. So that's not going to be allowed anymore.
And again, these are both in the AHL only, but these are likely going to graduate to the NHL as well.
And then the other one I think is interesting, I can understand it at the AHL level just from marketing and sales, is teams will wear light jerseys at home until Christmas break and dark jerseys at home after the Christmas break. A little bit confusing for a fan, but I can understand why they want to do that to market both of them. But that's kind of weird in the league that you're going to have – it's going to be confusing. You know, you're watching hockey before Christmas. You see one thing as a casual fan. You might not know it's changed. So that'll get kind of confusing. But the weirdest thing to me still in the AHL is this 76 games for most teams, 68 games for six teams. That's something they're going to have to sort out next year.
Well, if the Pacific Division teams, with the inclusion of Las Vegas afterwards, there will be eight Pacific Division teams in the NHL. There likely will be eight Pacific teams in the AHL. So you could have the one division just playing the 68 games and all the other ones.
Even that I'm not a fan of, because it's like, well, why does one division get less games than the other? That's weird when you're trying to compare everybody at the end. I think you almost need to either realign your divisions or just come up with something standard.
Yeah, well,
can you imagine the NHL if we said, oh, the Pacific Division plays 72 games and everyone else is going to play 82?
Well, a large portion of that has to do with the distance for travel for all the AHL teams. Because it's not like you can go take a bus from one part of California to the next, like to some other state entirely. Like, there's a large distance between the teams, so it's got to be planned a little better. Where in the East, like, they're all pretty much right next to each other, so...
But in that case, I just drop the games for the whole league.
Yeah.
Like, I just think it creates imbalance. I'd rather have less games and more training time at the AHL level.
I agree, and I think that may be where the league is headed. But like how they're experimenting with these rules, I'm sure they're experimenting with having eight fewer games in the one division to see if it works better for all of the divisions.
Yeah, I'm hoping so. It's just a weird thing to keep doing for 2 years. I could see it for 1 year while they're realigning things, but it's weird they brought it back.
Yeah. Well, it's just like in politics in the United States, each state is its own laboratory of policies, so, and supposed to see the best policies get graduated to federal law, so they're trying different things in the different regions in the AHL to see if it makes sense to go global.
I don't know about you, I don't have any other thoughts from today.
No, it was a fun week. It was nice to see some hockey again in person in July. So
it's weird because we see the hockey in July, we start to get excited, and then we, you know, disappear, and hockey disappears for another
2 months.
2 months. I was going to say a month and a bit. But yeah, pretty much 2 full months until we start seeing it again.
Yeah. At least it was a fun experience. Got to see a lot of new faces in the organization and get to see all the new guys, and hoping that some of them translate up the ladder into the NHL moving forward. And it's also good to see that the Flames are taking players from all different styles of player, so that way, like, when Calgary runs into those cap problems like Chicago did, that they'll be able to sub out different players with younger guys that can play approximately the same type of game.
Yeah, I don't think you ever want to draft a certain type of player to say this guy is going to replace this other guy, but I can definitely see, you know, you want to have different styles so that you can always mix it up. You can say this year we need this type of player on the roster, or, you know, we're going to need this type of winger in 2 years. We have one in the system. And people always talk about taking the best player available, that's why you do it. Because if you're always saying, oh, this year we need right wingers, let's take a bunch of them. Well, these guys take 4 or 5 years to develop.
Well, it's like back in 2005, Daryl Sutter wanted a replacement internally for Rhett Warner, and he took Matt Pellick. Well, that really did not help or work out. So, you know, the Flames are taking the best player available, and it just so happens that when they're picking, there's all sorts of different styles of player, whether it's a short skill player like Phillips or a massive player like Kanzig. Each one can fill a different need depending on what happens organizationally.
Yeah, and I mean, for sure, when we had Daryl Sutter here, we saw him draft a lot of the same type of player. It was that Western Canadian, big, tough,
gritty
guy.
Yeah.
And, you know, no matter what round we're in, and I think now we're definitely seeing different styles of players taken. I mean, you know, Tuilola is a very different player than Mattson is. Mattson's a very different player than Hickey is. You know, we're seeing all these guys at different types of players and also at different draft positions. I mean, it used to be with this team that you could pretty much write off any pick after round 3 or 4. I mean, we never had seconds because Sutter used to love to trade those away. So
and when he did use it, he picked Mitch Wall, which that was a great pick.
So we'd have ones and threes and sometimes a fourth, and then you could write it off. And I think the team is being more experimental now. They're not as afraid to take a chance in rounds 5, 6, and 7. And we're seeing some interesting player types coming in because of that.
Yeah, whether it's a guy like Falkowski, who they just drafted in the 7th round, or Adam Olis-Mattson. Just different types of guys, but interesting mix. And if they turn out, hey, it's great. So at least they're finding decent options for the later round picks instead of like just pigeonholed guys like Tim Harrison and Austin Carroll, who are more just physical, defensive-minded forwards. They're finding a mix of everything. So.
And if those guys don't turn out, that's fine. I mean, we don't expect them to turn out that
no,
deep. And like if they take a player type that didn't work out, well, now you know next time what you do or don't want to draft.
Yeah, and realistically, only 1 out of 8 picks from the 4th round on will turn into an NHL player based on all the years of drafting and their success. So you have usually 5 picks after the 4th round. So, you know, if you're getting one player every other year out of the mix, that's great. The Flames recently have been getting a lot more hits than that. But
I think you're going to see in the NHL in general, as the salary cap, you know, continues to play a factor in how teams make up their roster, which, I mean, the salary cap's not going anywhere. You're going to see more young guys given an opportunity, more guys you've drafted come through because they're cheap. And I think you're also going to see more turnover because of that. I don't think you're going to see as many guys where, oh, you're a third liner, we like you, so we'll just re-sign you. I think you're going to see much more turnover of, you know what, you're replaceable with the next young piece. So I think more...
Sort of like Colborne,
yeah,
for an example.
Colborne, you know, it's like, okay, we've taken you as far as we can. You're not worth the next contract to us, so we'll replace you with somebody younger. So I think you're going to need... going forward, more and more young guys that they might only play 2-3 years in the league or 2-3 years for your team, but you're going to need to be cycling those guys through. So you need more draft picks in the system.
Well, it's just like with Chicago. When they moved guys like Bolland and Brouwer, they needed guys like Saad and Shaw to come in. And now those guys are too much, so they've moved them on, and now they've got other guys coming in. And you just have, eventually what's going to happen is the key players like Gaudreau, Monahan, maybe Bennett, maybe Tkachuk, those guys will remain as the top guys, and like everybody else will just keep getting turned over.
Yeah, and I think the draft position, like what round you're taking in, is going to become less and less important in the future. And it's going to be more about, like you said, drafting, making sure every year you take certain types of players. You know, every year you're going to want to make sure you take... a score, you're going to want to make sure you take this or that or this other thing. And, you know, so that you've always got a certain number of everything in your system.
Yeah, because even at the best of times, the attrition rate for prospects is absurdly high. Like, realistically, between Shillington, Hickey, and Anderson, if you're just going on odds, one of those guys will turn out. You know, right now it looks like... it will be more likely that two or maybe even all three might hit, but odds wise, it should only be one.
And I sound like a broken record, but, you know, I've said this over and over on the show. Remember that a prospect turning out doesn't mean they have to be a top two defenseman or top three forward. You know, if you get a guy who turns out and he has a reliable career as a 5-6 defenseman, for some guys, that's all we need. Not every prospect.
Look at Michael Backlund. That was a home run of a pick, and yet he's just the third line center for this team. And yet that was one of the top picks in the entire draft, especially relative to the position, but he's not Monahan, he's not Bennett, he's not your go-to guy, but he is a very dependable, serviceable player in the organization. And that's what you need from players, and especially like late first-round picks. So hopefully later on when the Flames are in the playoffs, we get more of those style of home runs from our first...
Yeah, and that goes to, like I was saying before, is, you know, not every first is going to be in your top six. Just like not every seventh round is going to, you know, bust. I think even if the first round guy has a career, whether it's as a third line winger or a first line winger, as long as he's playing full time in the NHL for more than 5 years, I think we're going to start seeing that as, okay, this turned out well.
Yeah, exactly. Like if Poirier and Klimchuk basically become Michael Frolik type players in the NHL, then that's a great pick. So just have to be patient and wait and see and all that fun stuff.
Well, Matt, I think that pretty much concludes our training camp episodes. We'll have a couple more interviews after this one that we'll slice in here for everyone to listen to. And otherwise, you probably won't hear from us again until September.
Yeah, nice little break from listening to us and ramble on for hours on end. And then we'll be back in September and you get to be annoyed from us, rambling on again.
You have a good summer, Matt, and I will talk to you when the season opens.
Thanks for listening, everybody, once again. And nice seeing anybody that we ran into at Winsport. And thanks for listening.
Before we go, I do want to remind people to take our listener survey online. The listener survey only takes about 15 minutes to do, but the information we get allows us to make the show better for everybody. It allows us to make the show better for you guys. You're the ones who are doing this for. It allows us to do things more efficiently on our end to make sure that if there's stuff you guys don't like, we take it out. So definitely take our listener survey. If you want to leave your contact information, you can. It's not required. But if you do, we'll enter you into win a prize pack. And you can see the prize pack on our website under the news section. If you go to firesidechat.ca/survey, you can take the survey. And like I said, it doesn't take more than about 15 minutes. It's totally anonymous unless you want to leave us your information. So if you can do that for us, that would be great. Otherwise, have a great summer, and we'll see you guys in September. Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.